Well, actually, I can talk about kind of the impact of Escala and how it changed. Because I have been thinking, Beth and I have been working together for a long time on teaching since I first got here. And we've been doing different things like just-in-time teaching and studio teaching for 20-plus years now. But so I felt like a lot of, you know, the faculty development that we've gone through over the past 5, 6, 7 years is like, okay, I got all this, I've seen a lot of this. But I did the equity index and I found that even though I don't have the equity gap that shows up on the bottom lines in terms of D's and F's and W's, it was stark, the equity gap between my A, B, and C's. So my students of color are not the A students, not even the B students, they're the lower B and the C students. It was really surprising to me. And I guess, I don't know why it was so surprising, I just never paid attention to it before, which just was such a huge shift for me in terms of thinking about why have I never noticed that before? Because I felt like, well, students are passing my classes. They're, you know, I feel like they're doing well. But when I went and actually looked at the breakdown between A, B, and C, which is what they had us do at Escala in a little more detail, it was shocking. And it happened 2 semesters in a row, which, because I think I'm doing all of these things, like active learning, think, pair, share, you know, just in time, having them do quizzes online before class, and that they're engaged. But it's obviously a different experience between my underrepresented students and my the white males in an engineering classroom.
So how did you approach that?
I mean, that's...
After I got over being so bummed out about it, I was just, well, that's what really made me think I am missing something here. And Escala was really opening my eyes about that in terms of thinking about things like, so like the student voice, you know, so they had all these ideas about popsicle sticks, and we've been in those conversations about pulling a stick and trying to share share student questions. And one thing I've started doing, because the classroom is flipped a lot of the times, and so I'm walking around, I started actually just tracking, just check mark, who I talk to in a class, and how many questions I answered. And at first I was just tracking it without trying to do anything different. And again, it was shocking. I was spending 80% of my time on 4 students who were asking lots of questions without even having any kind of real awareness of that. There were students I never talked to. So I tracked that for about 2 sessions. And then I said, okay, and I told the class, I tried to be really transparent. I said, okay, I am keeping track of who I'm talking to, and I am going to talk to every single person in the class. And so if you've already asked me 2 questions, and you, even if you have your hand up, you're going to have to wait until I've checked in with other people. And it was just amazing to me how it, I mean, I've kept that up. I just keep track, and I check in with every single person, even if it's a 50-minute period or a 3-hour period. And I'm always amazed, you know, people that will never ask me questions always have great questions. Mm-hmm. When you go up, and even when you first say, how you doing? Like, do you have any questions? They'll be like, no, I think I'm okay. And then if I push it and I say, well, what are you doing here? And then they'll say, oh, well, I'm doing this, but actually I don't really understand what's going on here, you know? And so they have some very well thought out questions that they just won't offer up unless they're asked, and more an individual basis. And so I felt really good about that. I feel like it's changed the whole equity of voice in the classroom. Mm-hmm. And talking to students that I didn't talk to before and that would not ask questions. And they have great questions. They have better questions than the students that are always asking questions.